Oh no. Sound the alarms, everyone. Sound the alarms. It's time once again to rank all of these Call of Duty pros. I know this is about to be a spicy one. Coming off of COD Champs just a few days ago, and now heading into Roster Mania, which has started off hot already, there is a ton to talk about and a lot of guys to rank. And this is going to be controversial, to say the least. So like I said, do not skip this intro, because I gotta explain where I'm coming at this from. Don't be skipping forward and taking a screenshot, posting it on Twitter with no context about why we're ranking these guys, where we're ranking these guys, all right? So basically how I'm gonna be going at this. The last one we did was based solely off Modern Warfare, how I saw the individual talents playing out heading into COD Champs. This one is how these individual talents are gonna play out heading in to Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War, and how that's gonna play out competitively, how that's gonna play out in Roster Mania. So of course we're gonna take Modern Warfare into context, but the performance in Modern Warfare, there's so many variables. It's not the end all be all with how these guys played. There's obviously so many other factors with not just how the game's gonna play in the future, with how Black Ops Cold War is gonna play, but we're going from 5v5 on an Infinity Ward Modern Warfare game to 4v4 on a Treyarch Black Ops Cold War game. So we're gonna have to take into consideration some of Modern Warfare, some of Black Ops 4, and maybe even some of World War II and the potential that these guys have shown, and kind of extrapolate that out and into their individual talent right now in 2020. It's not an easy task, and it's gonna be controversial. And I know a lot of you guys are gonna have your own opinions about certain guys that should have been way higher or way lower or whatever it is. So of course, I do like hearing your guys' respectful opinions down in the comments down below. So make sure to drop your opinions down as we're going through this video. But without further ado, now that you have a little bit of context for why I'm ranking these guys where I'm ranking them, let's get right into it. Let's go. So there's two big differences with how we're ranking the pros this time around. So the first difference right off the rip is that we're actually going to be including every player who started a match for a team this season in the Call of Duty League and rank them all out. So it ended up being 72 players, which worked out perfectly. So this is going to be our new number tier list here. We're going to do 8, 14, 14, 14, 14, 8 down the line here. When it comes to S tier, elite, great, good, decent, replaceable, we're going through it and we're going to sift these players out. Finally, after all this intro, let's start ranking these players. So off the rip, we're starting off with Dens. And again, considering our move to 4v4 and considering how Modern Warfare played out, I'm going to be a little biased, or not biased, but at least downgrade main ARs throughout the most part of this list. I mean, obviously there's gonna be some exceptions. I'm gonna be downgrading some of the main ARs because I feel like throughout the year, they've gotten a little bit, maybe too overhyped. Maybe that's partly my fault as well. But as the year's gone along, we've seen the value and the importance of slaying. And in 4v4, it's only gonna be more important to have those aggro SMGs. It's hard to rank guys at different positions in Call of Duty. And so when you're throwing them all together, it gets tough. But with all that said, Dens, I think off the rip, we're gonna throw him in the good category. He proved to be a solid player throughout this year. And at moments he looked dominant, and at moments he looked really, really, really good near the elite tier throughout moments of this year. He's a slower player, a solid main AR, and I think he fits in the good category pretty well overall. So Priest is up next, and again, he struggled throughout points in this year. He wasn't playing like the Priest that we expected to see. At the end of the year, he showed up when it mattered the most, and he made some massive plays for FaZe. I think he's in the elite category. He's a fantastic player. And of course, with FaZe back in World War II, he was a great player. He's been a great player for a long time. He's in the elite category for sure. Moving on to an interesting one is Illy. And again, throughout the year, he's kind of like been in the good and great categories, playing solid Call of Duty. But by the end of the year, maybe I'm giving him a little bit of that championship buff, that championship boost. But he really showed out, man. I was really, really impressed as a first-year player. He started off slow on LAN, but I think all of Empire got comfortable by the end of the year. And I fully expect Illy to be an elite player getting into Black Ops Cold War. I just really do think he's going to be an elite player moving forward. So Asim is up next, and he's an interesting case because statistically, he had a really rough season. I know people are going to be doubting him now heading into Black Ops Cold War after a pretty underperforming statistical season for him, but I think he's a really good SMG. I really, really do. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt and put him in the good category. He was really good in Black Ops 4. I think he can be a menace on the maps of the SMG, and moving forward, I fully expect him to be a good player in the future. So Zed is up next, and he's a tough one as well. I feel like he's gonna be here down here somewhere. I think I'm gonna put him in the tiebreakers category for now. Kind of depends on where guys end up sifting out, you know? And that takes on to another really, really tough one to deal with is Draza. Man, I mean, he looked good. He looked good for Optic, but like how much are we basing this off of just a few events? It's hard to say. There's no way I'm willing to go higher than good for Draza right now, but from what we saw from them, there's no way I can go, like, it's hard for me to imagine I'm putting him in decent after how we've only seen pretty much good things from Draza as a whole. So I'm going to put him in the good category, but I don't feel great about it. I mean, maybe I'll leave him in the tiebreakers for now and see what happens. And we'll see where other guys sift out and we'll move forward with them a little bit later. We got Wuskin up next. And again, at points in Modern Warfare, Wuskin was an S tier player. He was insane early on in this year. But again, kind of that main AR dip when we're talking about these players. I'm going to put him in the elite category, but he's a fantastic player. And hopefully he can find a spot. They're currently free agents right now, so we'll see what happens. I'd imagine they probably end up with London Royal Ravens, but who knows? Alex is up next. And another difficult case here. At moments this year, earlier on in the year when the Rocket were dominating, he could have been maybe in the elite category in Modern Warfare because he was really, really, really good. And then he was in great for a while. Then he kind of slipped down into the good category. I'm going to put him in the tiebreakers. I think he might end up in the top of good or bottom of great. We'll see. We got Bance up next. I think I'm going to put him in the decent category. Probably makes the most sense for him. I mean, he's been like an okay role player for Toronto on the season. And he had some moments where he shined, especially later on this year when Toronto was finding their groove. But I'm not expecting anything insane from Bance moving forward. And we got Kenny up next. And man, do I buy into the Texas Kenny hype? And I do, baby. Kenny is going inside the top 22. The Texas Kenny, I legitimately believe like that's the potential we saw from Kenny. And again, last year in BO4, he started off slow. He did. But by the end of the year, he was really, really, really good. And maybe there's another situation this year where they start off slow. But at the end of the day, I fully expect Kenny to be on point in Black Ops Cold War within the first month or two. Oh, baby. Construct Shani. Shani is our next man up the list here. He's a tough case as well, man. These are not easy decisions. Again, he ended the year on a great note. Would I be surprised if he gets a spot next year? No, definitely. I think he could get a spot for sure. But I'm not convinced that he's still like a great player. I'm going to put him in the decent category for now. I think he can be a good contributor on a team for sure, but he really struggled for a long time during the season, getting acclimated to the starting lineup again after being on the bench. But Shani, again, he can move up the list for sure in the future, but for now I'm going to put him in decent and we'll go from there. We got Accuracy up next, and Modern Warfare, I wouldn't say was necessarily his year. Definitely not his best game, but I would expect him to bounce back next year and at least be a solid player to say the least. So I'm putting him in the good category. There's a world where he bounces back and is fantastic again, gets back to his like World War II form where he was one of the best players in the game. But let's put him in good for now, but with a guy who has potential to rise. Big Man App is up next, the father, the GOAT. And I'm gonna put him in the great category. I think in a Black Ops game, I fully expect Apathy to be a nasty man, a nasty, nasty man, and be a really, really good player for a team. We'll see what happens with that Seattle roster. It's going to be a wild time and there's a lot of potential outcomes. I think no matter what team he goes on, he's going to be a contributor for sure and definitely help a team be successful. We got Pander up next. You know, Apathy's teammate, as much as I love Pander, I might have to do it to him, man. I might have to just put him down in the replaceable category. I'm sorry, homie. I'm sorry. But again, there's a world where he can figure things out, but he had a lot of opportunities this year and never really played out. And I know we haven't seen as much of him in the past. It's tough to say. When most of what we've seen from a guy is in Modern Warfare, there's a lot of other factors when it comes to how they could play in Black Ops Cold War. I mean, from all we've seen, I think we got to put him in replaceable for now. Let's move on to Havoc. Man, yeah, he's right in between good and decent. He's probably right on the back of good or the front of decent, probably. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt and put him on the good squad. I mean, he was on Gen G last year. He was on the Mutineers this year. I know his champ success has been, it's been tough for him, man, in his career in champs. But I definitely think he can be a good contributor on a championship team. So we'll throw Havoc in the good category. Vivid's up next. And again, we saw the flashes of Vivid this year, but there was never consistency. And in Respawn, it was never really there. In S&D, he flashed for moments and looked really, really good at points. But I feel like I got to throw him in the decent category for now. I do have a lot of hope for Vivid as a player, though. I'd love to see him with a better roster next year. I'd love to see him with a better surrounding roster and see what he can do in a better environment. But for now, we're throwing him in decent. We got the Italian Stallion up next, Zuma. And I think great makes the most sense for Zuma overall. We always know the potential that Zuma has. I'm not sure if Modern Warfare played to his strengths that much, but in a Black Ops game and moving forward with Call of Duty, I fully expect Zuma to be a great player in the COD scene moving forward. Alrighty, we got Saints up next. And I think decent makes the most sense for him. I think that's a pretty fitting category overall. Again, a good role player for LAG on the season. In the past, he's had success on certain teams in certain situations, but moving forward into Black Ops Cold War, I don't expect him to be some dominant player in Black Ops Cold War, though. We got Shotzi. And I mean, after this season with Modern Warfare, I don't know how you can justify putting him outside the top eight right now. He's been an insane player in Modern Warfare. I know he struggled early, but in scrims online before the season, they were looking great. He struggled at the first LAN, but then they won the LA home series and they didn't look back since playing online. And all things considered, it's impossible not to have Shazzy inside the top eight right now. He has been dominant, and I'm excited to see what he can do on a Black Ops game next year. Blast up next time, we expect, again, a lot of LAG's roster kind of be hovering around in this decent category. We all thought that maybe there was a chance Blast to kind of ascend to another level online, but I didn't really feel like that was the case. It'll be interesting to see how he ends up dealing with a 4v4 meta moving forward, considering that's kind of where he was like at his best earlier on in CODs. But we'll see what happens with him. I'm not exactly convinced it's going to work out for Blast either in the future. That's why he's indecent. Attach, man. And I really think Attach is a really, really, really good player. I'm going to put him in the elite category. I feel like I'm a little bit higher on Attach than some people. And last time people were surprised that I put Attach as high as I did. I'd imagine he's going to have a lot of motivation to grind and fry next season. So all things considered, I expect Attach to come out and be a beast on the sticks early on in Black Ops Cold War. Dylan might be the most difficult guy to slot out of any player in the league because of how dominant he was in Black Ops 4 and then moving into Modern Warfare, how he really struggled at times and could never find his groove. We always were basically asking like, yo, what if Dylan was a beast? What if he'd get back to his Black Ops 4 form? But it never really happened. So heading back to a Black Ops game, do we expect Dylan to be a monster? I kinda do, but I feel like I need to hedge my bets and throw him in the great category. He's in pretty good company inside the great category, so I feel pretty good about that. Kismet was on deck, and I think I'm gonna throw him in decent as well. Again, it's tough because early in the year, people were like, yo, Kismet's nasty. Look at that, man. Look at it. And it never really panned out for him throughout the year. It just kind of felt like Paris was always missing something. I like the guy, but at the end of the day, at the back of the decent category, probably makes the most sense for him right now. Mac is a tough one to grade as well, man. Do you throw him in the elite category? Do you throw him in the great category? Honestly, I don't know. I'm going to put him in the tiebreakers category for now because I need to see who else ends up in these areas before I make a decision on Mac. Pharaoh is next up. And again, I don't feel like he got a fair shake on 100 Thieves last year. It just didn't work out for him and how that roster wanted to play together, all things considered. But he was a beast in World War II. He was a beast in Modern Warfare. Heading back to 4v4 COD, I think he's an elite player. He's really, really, really good at Call of Duty. And what changed for Mutineers? Pharaoh joined that team. He's the first person to join that team out of all the guys they added in. It really turned them around. They saw how good he was and they didn't even know what to do at first because they're like, oh my word, this guy's nasty. I guess we have to drop Pristini, which they didn't want to drop Pristini, but it just kind of had to play out that way. Obviously, all things worked out in the end for both parties. But Pharaoh's a really, really good player. I expect him to be a beast in Black Ops Cold War. Decimate is up next. Again, man, I'm going to throw him in a decent category, kind of like the LAG party here in the decent category. All things considered, there's potential still there, but there's nothing too exciting about Decimate at this point. Decent feels totally right for him. Frosty is up next, and I think I need to throw him in the good category. I mean, it's a weird spot for him. I felt like he might be in a tough spot for what ends up shaking out with rosters next season, but it is hard to say. I would imagine he'll still be in a decent spot, so I'm going to throw him in good, and I'm feeling pretty good about that as well. So now Silly, and again, I feel like good makes a lot of sense for him as well. The Minnesota Rocker situation, like him and a Sim, kind of put in a tough spot on the season where with how their metas played out and how their ARs wanted to play and, you know, with Assault and with God RX, and then you bring in Exceed and all the situation was just a tough spot overall for the team, you know? And so all things considered, I still expect Silly to be a solid player moving into Black Ops Cold War as well. Hollow is up next. And all right, I mean, if we put Draws over here, we got to put Hollow over here. Again, tough spot for both teams. I'm going to put him in good for now and see what happens. And we'll come back to him in a little bit. Skies is up next. And I think he's an elite player, man. He really, really, really is. Even moving into Black Ops Cold War, I know some people are probably going to be like, yo, what, dude? This guy's an onliner, man. But he was good for LG last year. If you don't remember, looking back on Black Ops 4, he was really, really good before he moved to LG. And then he comes into Modern Warfare, was good at the beginning of the year on LAN. And then they switch around their pieces, and then he was dominant. And so all things considered, Skies is definitely an elite player. Maybe. I'm not going to guarantee it, but there's a chance. There's a chance S tier. We'll see how it plays out with the top eight. right now. We're only got one in there, so we'll see what happens. Shox up next, and man, I don't know how I feel about Shox. I feel like I might have to put him in replaceable. I'm not necessarily a believer. I mean, obviously, I think there might be some better options out there for Paris overall, so we're going to keep him in replaceable for now. Pristini's up next. I think Pristini's a good player. I really, really do. He helps teams win. He can be a valuable asset for a team. I will be very interested to see what happens with him in Roster Mania this year, you know, with whether or not he duos with Arcides or if he finds his own roster once again. I'm excited to see what happens because in those last few series, Pristini was playing really, really well and like honestly frying and making big time plays for the Huntsman when it mattered the most. And so you kind of saw that championship attitude from Pristini. He played some of his best Call of Duty on the season in champs. So those are things you absolutely love to see. And he was dominant on teams with United. So it's like, I'm honestly was tempted to put him in the great category, but we'll leave him in the good for now. Methods up next, and I think he's in either the good or great categories as well. I'm going to put him in the great category. I think Methods is a beast. He's a tank, man. I know he's one of the slower players in the league, and I know I was saying I was nerfing ARs, so maybe I should put him in tiebreakers, but I really do believe in Methods as a player. I'm going to leave him in great. And we got Arcides up next. Man, there's a chance he could go S tier. I'm going to put him in the tiebreakers for now because I'm not sure there's a chance he goes S tier. And we'll see what happens. Assault is up next. And man, I think I'm going to put him in the good category. You know, I could see an argument for putting him in the great category. I don't think I really have any problem with that. Considering he won champs in World War II and considering his pedigree as a player the past, you know, 2.5, 3 years, he's been really, really, really good. But for now, let's leave Salt in good. Now we've got Simp, and this is an obvious S tier right here. You know, no matter the game, I think he's going to be an absolute monster on the sticks. I mean, last year he was the best player. This year, he was one of the best players, if not the best player on the season. He's fantastic. You've got to throw him in the S tier with Shotzi. Next, we got Hook, and he's been a constant riser. I'm putting him in the elite category. I really, really do believe in Hook at this point. I know last year was a weird year with Black Ops 4 with how it played out with Splice and the whole trades, everything else at the end of the year. It was weird, and so like it kind of put a bad taste in everybody's mouth heading into Modern Warfare, and then he didn't shine. Let's just say he didn't shine early on. But we saw the dominance of Hook at champs and what he can be. I really do think Hook's an elite player and deserving of the category for sure. Next, we got Formal on the sticks. We got some really, really good players here lined up. Holy moly. We got Formal up next. I think he's an elite player as well. I should have sorted these out a little bit better because look at this lineup we got coming up. But Formal, of course, is a fantastic player and is definitely one of the top 22 players in the league. I don't think we got to say much more about Formal. We know how good he is. Slasher is right there as well, man. And wow. Again, there's an argument for S tier for Slasher as well. I'm going to throw him in the tiebreakers and come back to him. Crim 6, the COD champs, the COD finals MVP. Do you put him in great? Do you put him in elite? For the benefit of the doubt, because I know what he brings to a squad. He brings a lot to a squad as a leader. And so those intangibles is what's going to put him in the elite category. As an individual talent, he's probably in the great category. But at the end of the day, Crim 6, this far into his career, Crim 6 is still fantastic and is obviously still a winner. And that's got to mean something. So we're throwing him in the elite category for sure. We've got Skump, the king, up next. And again, I know some of you want to throw him in the top 8. And he had a great champs. He did. He had a fantastic champs and really proved a lot of people wrong. That people were doubting that he was a top, 15, 20 player in the league. But he proved that he is definitely in that category. So I 100% agree that he's solidified inside the top 22. And heading into a Black Ops game where we've seen Skump be pretty good in the past, I'll be very interested to see what happens with him and how well he plays. He's definitely inside the elite category. He's a beast. Oh, baby. Another interesting one here, Awakening. He dominated inside of Modern Warfare. Now, the question is, do I buy into the hype? I'm not sure. I honestly don't know. It's a really, really, really tough call. I'm going to hedge my bets. I'm going to hedge my bets and throw him inside the great category. And some of you guys are now pissed. You guys are flying down to the comments to roast that this guy's been a beast on the sticks, whatever. Yeah, I know. He's been great. But again, he needs to prove it a little bit more on LAN or on a new game, one of the two at least, before I am convinced that he's going to be a top 22 player in the league at this point heading into a new game. I think it's even generous to throw him in the great category, but his dominance early on has to mean something. So for now, we'll throw him in the great category. Well, I just realized my camera went out. That's great for about 7 minutes there. So fantastic. We're on here with Envoy now. So welcome back to my face. Great to see you. But we got Envoy now. And again, he's right on the fringe of S tier and elite. I'm going to throw him in the tiebreakers category and talk about him more in a little bit, but he's right there. So then we got Luca. And I think I'm going to throw him in the decent category. You know, there were moments when Luka looked really, really good, moments where he didn't. I think there's still potential for him to move up, but for now, we're leaving him in decent. Then we got Octane. Again, I still truly believe he's an S-tier player. You know, some people can argue that he was stat-whoring on the season and just playing for him and not playing for the team, which, you know, is an argument to be had for maybe a lot of the ARs in this game. I'm sure some of the subs feel like they're just getting baited all the time with how the ARs played in this game. It's hard to say with how that debate plays out from team to team. It's probably on a very individual basis, but Octane's a beast and definitely an S-tier player. Next, we got Exceed. And I'll be honest, I don't necessarily buy into the hype. I'm going to keep him in the replaceable category, and we'll keep moving forward on that one. We got Kleenex up next, and oh man, he's right on the fringe of good and great. I'm going to throw him right here for now and see what we can do, come back to him. We got Celium. He's definitely an S-tier player. I mean, that's just no doubt about that at all. He's insane, incredibly good at this game, and incredibly good at Call of Duty as a whole. And I fully expect him to be a monster in Black Ops Cold War as well. So we got Scraps. And again, I love Scraps as a player. I hope Black Ops Cold War can help him return to his elite S-tier near form from last season. For now, we're going to throw him in the great category. He's definitely a fantastic player and a very valuable asset to a team, especially in a Cold War game. I'm excited to see what he can do moving forward, to say the least. We got a BZ up next, and he's an S-tier player, man. I know there was moments this year where he struggled and wasn't his a BZ self, but we saw it at the end of the year how good a BZ is in Modern Warfare, and it was playing out in champs and near the end of the year in Toronto and on Cold War in a game like that in 4v4. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out for these guys like Shotzi and Simp and Cell and a BZ coming up in the 4v4 now in the pro scene. Come on, man. I fully expect them as individuals where they can shine individually in gunfights a little bit more now that it's going to matter. It's going to play out for them, and they're going to be in a really, really good spot. Abizi's nasty. So Tiege is an interesting case. I would imagine, you know, if you watch him on the year, he was terrible. For a long time, he was really, really bad on Modern Warfare. He was not a good Modern Warfare player. And again, if I was grading just on Modern Warfare, I'd probably put him in the decent category. But because I'm not just grading on Modern Warfare, I'm kind of, you know, extrapolating, looking into Black Ops Cold War. I think he's going to be a great player in Black Ops Cold War. It might be one of my hotter takes because he was so bad in Modern Warfare on the season. But again, we saw in Champs where Tiege kind of stepped up and played the best Call of Duty of his whole season. So again, with practice in a game that he actually really likes, I would expect him to be right back to being a really, really, really good player. Let's throw him inside the great category. We got Slacked up next. And again, I don't know if the potential is there for Slacked anymore. The upside seems like kind of like more of a very consistent player and one that you can rely on, but I'm not sure where the upside lies for Slack at this point. I'm going to throw him in the decent category and stick with that. We got Temp up next. And again, not Temp's greatest year. There was times in the past where he would have been maybe a top 8, top 10, top 12 player in the league. This year, it wasn't the case. I'm going to throw him inside the great category, but moving in forward into a Black Ops game, there's a world where he quickly flies right back in to like the top 10 and is an absolute monster at the beginning of the season next year. We got Major Maniac up next. I think he's a great player. I really, really do. He's really, really valuable to a team. He was great for Gen G last year. He was great for FaZe this year. And anyone who's just like, he's getting carried by his teammates. I mean, sure, he played a really slow role and maybe that ends up coming back to bite him later on in a 4v4 and how that's going to play out with a roster for him. So I would have no problem with somebody putting him like the good category. But for now, I think I'm going to keep him in the great category. He is a really, really good player. Now we got another three-time champion. We got Clayster. And again, I'm giving him the championship benefit of the doubt and throwing him inside the elite category. I could see somebody arguing that he's not individually as talented as a lot of these guys inside the great category, which I could see. But again, there's so much of these guys bring intangibly to a team. I expect him to have a lot of success regardless at Black Ops Cold War. So we're throwing him inside the elite category. We got Classic up next. I think he's a decent player. Again, the upside is just a little bit questionable with him as well. And we got Aqua. I think it's the same boat. It's kind of the LAG, just kind of decent category of players. It's hard to say exactly how they're going to play out. And then we got Zero. And I think Zero is a good player. I'm going to throw him inside the good category. He can help a team win for sure. And we saw that with London, the upside that they had at Champs. He was a valuable asset to that team and definitely helped them win. And we've got our last two players of the current starting rosters. We got Cammy and Proto. Cammy, man, he's a tough category as well. I'm going to throw him in the tiebreakers for now. And then we got Proto, and I'm going to throw him in the replaceable. So now we're down to just the substitute players, all right? There they all are. We got Dashy, the man himself, the benched phenom himself. He's going to be up here somewhere. I'm going to throw him in the tiebreakers for now and talk about him a little bit more in a second. We got Enable up next. I think Enable's a good player and can help teams win. And in Black Ops Cold War and 4v4, I fully expect Enable to be on a roster, be competitive, and be a good player on a team when he really enjoys the game like he does in Black Ops Cold War. Throw him in good for now. And we got Jurd, another guy who's kind of a tough one to rank and figure out where he fits exactly. He's right on the fringe as well, so we'll throw him in the tiebreakers for now. Then we got GodRx. He's a tough one, man. He's a tough one. Man, I would love to say that GodRx is a greater elite player. It's just hard to say, like, with how he plays Call of Duty, it's definitely a little bit different. And he gets the stats, that's for sure. I'm going to throw him in the good category. And that might be a hot take as well for people. I don't want to be a hater because I actually really like him as a guy. And I like him as a player. And I definitely think he can be really valuable. But I'm not exactly sure how that's going to translate to Black Ops Cold War. So that's why I'm just kind of, you know, negating risk and throwing him a little bit farther down the list. So we'll throw him in good. Rated is up next, and I'll throw him in the decent category. Again, maybe, kind of. But I'm not exactly convinced. And then we've got Gunless. And I'm going to throw him in the tiebreakers as well. That's a tough conversation to be had. Happy is here. I mean, let's be honest. He's irreplaceable. We're flying through these ones now, guys, because this is a long video already. And I'm trying to keep this at least a reasonable length. So we've got Lacefield now. I'm going to throw him in indecent as well. We got Looney. I still think Looney's a good player. And he brings a lot to a team. Again, as an individual, maybe you could debate that he's not as talented as some of the guys in that tier. But what he brings to a team, he's really, really valuable. And we got Mox. I'm going to throw him in the good category. Then we got Metals. I'm going to throw him in decent. And we got Spart. We're throwing him in replaceable. So we have some numbers to work through here. So let's start at the top and figure this out. So S tier. Right now, we've got Shotzi, Simp, Octane, Cell, and Abizi. We need three more. That is a tough decision. Right now we've got Slasher, Envoy, and RCD's kind of waiting in the tier here. I could see an argument for Pharaoh, Skies. Some people are going to argue Skump. Some would argue Priesta. Some would argue Wuskin. I might just slot these guys in as they are and honestly go RCD's, Envoy, and Slasher as the S tier players. I know it's controversial to have Slasher over like Wuskin, Skies, and Formal, but that's probably going to be one of my hotter takes on this side. And we'll go from there. So I'm sorry, guys. I definitely like Slasher as a player a lot. I think he's an absolute unit. So I think that means we can now throw Gunless and Dashy into the elite category because we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So that's perfect. So we got our S tier and elite categories now knocked out. Looks like we need a handful more people inside the great categories because we only got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we need 5 more people inside the great category, which means we're going to slot Mac. We're going to slot Alex. We're going to slot Cammy. We're going to slot Kleenex. So we need to slot one more person into the great category. I'm going to give the benefit of the doubt to accuracy. I think in a 4v4 meta, he could come out here and be nasty. So that's where we're going to go with that. We're going to throw him right there. And then we're going to throw Draza and Hollow into the good categories, which means we're going to throw Zed and Jurd into the decent categories. And then we need to move, what, two guys down from decent to replaceable? That's not easy to do. Oh my word. So let's move down Metals and Lacefield down to the replaceable. And that is what we end up getting here. I mean, I will be beyond interested to see what you guys have to say about this final tier ranking heading into Roster Mania. I know I've got some controversial takes, some guys who I downgraded after Modern Warfare where I had them really, really high before. I would imagine some of the guys will be like Skies, Awakening, Mac, some of the younger guys from Modern Warfare who I kind of moved down the list. I could see like Shawnee, Pristini, Paulo, and Draza being pretty controversial as well. So I'll be interested to see what you guys have to say about those guys. But overall, I'm feeling pretty good about this list as a whole. The S tier is pretty tough. That was a tough debate with those last few guys. And you could slot in a handful of those guys, and I would have no problem with that at all. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you guys did, like, comment, subscribe. Hopefully it wasn't too controversial. I do appreciate all the support. I'm trying to do this full time, and I cannot do that without you guys. So I really, really do appreciate it. But as always, guys, I'm your boy, Space Elite, and we will see you next time. I'm out.